Okay, I'm going to go through this section. We're going to talk now a little bit about what's called big data hubris. So this overconfidence in what big data can do. One of the poster childs of big data success was a paper that was written in Nature by a set of researchers from Google Research and various academic institutions. What they were looking at was whether they could take these search queries, so queries that, like, let's say I would have put in this morning, fever, aching, joints, headache. By taking a set of search queries in particular locations around the country, maybe I could use those as a way of predicting which areas need the flu vaccine first. You know, where is flu outbreaking in the United States? Now, this is really exciting. And I will say at the time, when I read this article, as someone who's been working in this for some time, I was excited. And I was sort of touting it. I remember taking it to my class saying, look at this. This is, see, big data really is amazing. They then developed a website. This was something they did in collaboration with the CDC, the Center for Disease Control. They put up a website where you could select the state of Washington here. I selected the state of Washington. I could see what the prediction was saying, where the algorithm thought there would be bursts of this activity. Big data really is changing the world. This was all over the news. This was the example. This is what the data science and the big data world needed. It was showing businesses and governments that if you give a machine enough data and if the analytics are good enough, we can save humanity. Because a lot of people die every year. A lot of people die from flu, even in the United States, every year. So this was published in one of the best journals in the world saying that we can do as well as the CDC. In fact, we can do even better. We can do it even faster. I should have been thinking about this. Seems too good to be true. Well, probably is. So this website that I mentioned, this was circa 2014. It's 2017 today. The site is dead. What's unfortunate is this example went from the poster child of data science success and where it was, you know, it was the point to example for why data science really was transforming the world. It soon became the poster child for the data science foible, for the data science example that didn't work. So what happened? Anyone have ideas of why it failed? I know some of you have had some of you in my class on some of these. Think about that for a sec. I'm going to keep us going because we have lots of material, so I'm not going to let you talk to your neighbor. I'm sorry. Why did the Google Flu Project fail? An article by David Lazier and colleagues that was recently published not too long after this wrote a really scathing, it was scathing, but it was also fair because they do big data and data science as well, their group. But they showed that it's their predictions, this what was a really sad fact was that from about 2011 on, Google was overestimating 100 out of the 108 weeks from that particular time period. There were some years, like in 2013, that it was overestimating by over 50%. Now, that's a huge overestimate. And that's if you're 100 out of 108 weeks, you're off. What you're looking at here is the orange line. So it was overestimating all these. In fact, what they found is that if you just took a simple model, like tracking the temperature from some previous time point, that little simple model would do a better job of predicting. And of the 45 terms, search terms that they were using, they also found that terms like high school basketball were popping up as good predictors of the flu, which of course was probably a seasonal thing. And since flu is seasonal, you sort of pick those sorts of things out. So they wrote this very, really, I think, important article. And what I like about it is they say, here's where it went wrong, but we still think that this sort of thing can be useful. We just need to complement rather than supplement. So this big data hubris is this idea that all we need is the data. We don't need any of these other traditional methods of doing flu prediction or whatever your task is. What happened, and we won't have time, I'm not going to talk to about it in detail, but Carl is. We're going to talk about one of the reasons that this failed was something that's called overfitting. So we're going to take an attempt here to explain to you what overfitting is in just a few minutes. But I will say, here's one, you know, from this project, there were things that were learned. One is that we really should be getting at complementation rather than supplementing. And big data is not always better data. Traditional applied statistics are still going to be useful. And there isn't this so-called all data evolution.